Welcome back to our show. Once again, my name is Mrs. Augustina Anyanwa. Help me welcome my friend.
Glory Ezema. Welcome back to our sweet home, Africa. It's always a pleasure to have you as our viewer. All right, today we have another topic. Our topic today is confusion in the church. The church. All over, especially in Africa. There's a lot of confusion going on in the church lately. I know, Christianity came to us many, many years ago. And then people came in, they introduced the religion. But what we're seeing now and what we're hearing is much different from what we know that our church is supposed to be. So that's why my friend and I were here today, to give you a little insight of what we've had, what we have seen, and what we have experienced ourselves too. And then share advice like we usually do, that we believe that will help both the congregation and the pastors and priests and religious leaders. So my dear friend, are you hearing about the confusion that is going on in the church?
Yeah, too many things we hear every day. Yes.
Okay, so go ahead and tell our viewers. Yes, what you know.
It's very, very disheartening to hear that there is confusion in the house of God, a family that's supposed to be together. And they're humiliated. And first of all, when there is confusion, even in the home, there will be division. There will be breakups. So that's exactly what we see in many churches today. And that been going on. As a result, when there is confusion like that, some people will leave the church and go and find a room or find a space somewhere else and start worshiping their own God. And not only that, they are worshiping God and preaching and praying, then they will start bringing out what the other pastor wasn't doing right or what was going wrong in that as a sermon. So, and that being said, any lay person can see it to be ungodly. So today we are going to continue to see what we have to do so there'll be tranquility in the house of God. I'm going to talk about, take it step by step. Let us talk about disunity in the house of God. So what caused disunity? As a result of confusion, there'll be disunity and there'll be fashion. So when the pastor, maybe pastor and assistant pastor, get into disagreement for one thing or the other, they will think the congregation don't know. And then some congregations, members of the church will be, you know, loyal to the pastor, and then some will be loyal to the assistant pastor. And then they start airing each other's mistake in public. And that will cause breakup because people are crossing paths. There is, in the house of God, there's supposed to be unity. As we know that our God is not the author of confusion, and that he specified in the Bible, God is not the author of confusion. There is stage by stage. We have pastors, we have preachers, we have prophets,
that's true,
we have administrators, so that nobody will cross paths. We have evangelists. So there are so many work, according to the Bible, there are so many work in my father's home. So people shouldn't fight because of one position or the other. So I will let my friend to take over from here.
Thank you so much for everything that you said so far, because it's very disheartening when we hear about the confusion in the church. At a point, you ask yourself, are they fighting over souls or are they fighting over money? Because what we know, from Christianity especially, is that the person that brought Christianity is Christ. So that means to be a Christian means you have to be Christ-like. And not what we're fighting over every day in terms of disunity. Just like my friend said, it's almost like even in medicine, you have doctors that specialize in different things. You have surgeon, you have dentist. That's the same in the church. Just like my friend said, you have people that are prophets, you have teachers. You have administrators. Mm-hmm. I mean, they could be a pastor, but they're administrators. And it doesn't mean that they have to preach every week. So we all have different things that we do. And it's not that, even in the Bible, it says, it's not that one is greater than the other.
That's right.
But when we start fighting over something, then you're like, okay, it looks like they're not trying to win souls. They're trying to get money. And that's where the confusion is coming from. So if you are a man of God, that's what we call it all over now. And if you're called for something, if you're a teacher, stay in your lane and teach people about the word of God. Yes. You don't have to prophesy. You have to don't have to tell them that this is what God said when you have not heard from God so that they can give you money. Be a teacher because the body of Christ needs teachers that will teach us the word of God and then teach it correctly. And then if you're a prophet, you don't have to be a teacher. You might not even know so much in the Bible. But the only thing is that you hear from God and this is what you want to tell the people. Stay in your lane and stop crossing, crossing and crossing. And then when you are, well, like we said, you might be a prophet and you might be a teacher, but you will need an administrator to handle the affairs of the church. So in that case, yes, they might make you a pastor, but maybe your role in the church is to be the administrator. That means you have to organize things for the pastor and organize things for the preachers and organize things for the teachers. So you don't have to struggle to be what somebody else is. And that's why we hear all this confusion. People are running helter-skelter, going from one place, starting a church. Sometimes they're like, but just like you said, these are teamwork. Even in the Bible, you have Paul and Silas. You have, I mean, they've sent them in pairs. And then you can have a team. But when you keep on traveling solo like that, one by one, then you start fighting over money, not over souls. Go ahead, my friend.
My friend, we look at it. The next one, let's talk about caring. Actually, when we mention all this, the pastors, the bishop, the pope, the prophet, those that evangelize, whatever your own job is, whatever you know, that's what you're good at, as to be able to walk in the house of God or bring souls. You can be somebody who have a nicest voice, that when you sing, the angels are going to come down. So all these things, we work together, like my friend says, because when we work together like that, we become a church, we become one family, we become those that are for Christ as Christians, we become Christ-like, bringing unity. But now, what is our duty? To care. Do we care for the people outside? What I mean, the people outside, those that are completely not in your inner circle when it comes to that four walls of your building. So what do we do to care for other people, to win more souls for Christ? Is the next question, or the next question that we want to look into. Because knowing that the people that brought Christianity in our land, they started because they were helping people, they build schools, and they were not charging, they were not saying this is private school for the rich or private school for the poor. So they build schools, they build hospitals, they help to the extent they can because they're foreigners. Now we that are the indigents of this particular, any particular nation. So what do we do apart from asking people to sow seed? My friend, let me leave you to say something.
Oh, well, since you brought sow seed, what I call it is more like financial exploitation.
Okay.
So a lot of people have made church a business. So church has become business to a lot of people. And like we said, this is our sweet home Africa. So most of the things that we address are things that are happening in Africa as we speak. So a lot of people have turned the house of God into a business
center.
Exactly. A business center. Yes. So what they do now is, they exploit
members,
the congregation. So instead of helping them, because church is supposed to be, I call it a place of asylum. That people run in when they're going through emotional things, when they're going through financial, it could be anything. Especially though, it's mostly emotional and spiritual that you go in. But at the same time, the offering that is given in the church, it's also for people that are going through financial hardship. So it's supposed to be a welfare place, like a place to care for people. So the money that are brought in it's supposed to be for the congregation, not for the pastors. So it would take us to know exactly what a body of Christ is supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
So because once we know what we're supposed to do, and then we will understand that the congregation is not, they're not supposed to be exploited. They're there to get help.
Mm.
So they don't come in to get help, and then they are exploited in the process of trying to get help. So I'll let my friend go through the body of Christ, what people that call themselves Christians supposed to do, especially the pastors, people that are in charge of the congregation.
That's right, the leaders.
What you are expected to do. So go ahead, my friend.
My dear, what we know, or what I know, what I can contribute to that, I think, especially in Nigeria, most hospitals are kind of like in grade. It depends on your level financially. Mm-hmm. You will go to certain hospitals. Mm-hmm. So we look at it, the church is supposed to help the poor, whether they are among the church there or the members of the church or they are outside.
Mm-hmm.
They can help, and when they visit the hospitals, see the sick, they can talk to doctors and know the status. Can this person be able to pay their bills?
Mm-hmm.
You visit, you can give them food, you pray with them, and if anybody have any donation they can give, you can give or give it out of the purse. Because they're supposed to have like the a purse to visit the sick, so they can be able to help with their hospital bill or feeding the hungry. Feeding the hungry, what do you do? I'm talking based on where we are. Every Saturday, some people take it as their own job or whatever they want to do. They have fun doing that. They go and feed the homeless. Some churches give out food. You go there, you carry bags of food and go home. So the church will pack food. They're not going to ask you if you're a member of the church or not. Mm-hmm. Because they know for you to come there, you must be hungry.
Exactly.
So they pack different kinds of food. And they give everybody a bag. It's not that they look on your face and know if you deserve meat or no chicken.
Mm-hmm.
So the bag is already pre-packed. Once you come, you take yours, you go home. So that's among the job people do, to feed gas people. To make sure that during a certain time, over here is in winter, even out of winter, they give clothes. So the clothes that your children don't wear anymore, there might be other children that need that clothing. The material clothes, or even the clothes that you did at Shebi, you don't want to wear anymore. People need it. You take it, you give it to them, your church can use it even to evangelize, to bring more people to the church. Because they will come there on a particular month, maybe once a month. Whoever come there, you can take 100 people, you can take 200, as many as you can take. Those clothes, the suit, the pastor don't wear, the shoes you don't wear, give them out. The ones your children don't wear, give them out. Other people can be donating to your church because they know that you're doing something good. So that's among the things I can say. Even you can visit the prisoners too, right?
Exactly.
They visit, they go, they have prison ministry.
Mm-hmm.
Go there, pray for some people. Even those that we think they've been stealing, they're there in life imprisonment or other things. You visit, we hear from them, we pray with them, we give them assurance that God is in control. All we want them is to do what? Repent. That means you're doing what? You are evangelizing.
Mm-hmm.
You are bringing souls to Christ. Even if in human court, they say they're not coming out again because they did something horrible. They're not coming out again, but at least they can stay there and receive their own repentance. So the churches have too many assignments to do for God, too many work to do for God, other than fighting each other and finding fault who is preaching what. It's a personal call. Pastors, reverend, bishops, laymen, it is everybody's assignment. So let's stop the exploitation.
Thank you so much, my friend there. And actually, when my friend was talking, what I was thinking is this. I say, education is very good. But at the same time, a lot of Africans, many Africans, I'm sorry to say it that way, when we become educated, we use it to suppress our people instead of using it to uplift our people. So when I look at it in terms of the church and the topic that we said, confusion in the church, most preachers are the ones that are educated. And most of the congregation are uneducated. So what the preachers are doing is that, for the fact that they read the Bible because they're educated, they go and then translate it in such a way that it will suit them, even with the prosperity. So unfortunately, the congregation are not reading the Bible, so they don't know exactly the truth. Because when you look in the Bible, I don't know how many cars Jesus had. I don't know how many shoes. I know shoes are very simple, because when you look at the African pastors and the type of shoes that they're wearing, those shoes, even we live in the Western world, a lot of people cannot even afford those shoes. I go to a multicultural church in the Western world. It's a large congregation. I'm telling you, if you see our pastor, even if you walk on the street and he walks by you, you wouldn't even recognize him. As simple as anything, all he does is that in the morning he will get up there to preach. He doesn't have this multiple aircraft, multiple this and multiple this and multiple this. So I don't know where our African Christianity, I don't know when we have deviated from what we know. Because like I said, this is not what is in the Bible. But if the preachers can be honest and tell the congregation the truth, what is in the Bible, I think will help us to win the souls of the people. Because you hear it, you see it on the news, and everybody's saying Africans, they pray a lot, they clap a lot, and they are poor, and they are struggling, they are this. Every day they're in the church saying, I receive it, I receive it, I receive it, and still they're the poorest in the world. What is happening is not the congregation, it's the pastors that are telling them the wrong thing. And because you are educated, you're reading the Bible, and you know exactly the truth, but you're looking at the congregation and you're giving them a wrong message. You are confusing the people. That's what I want to say.
My dear, you are just right. So pastors, preachers, teachers, stop making our God a liar.
Yes.
Because you're promising people what you are not the one to give it to them in order to exploit them. Mm-hmm. They believe you. They look at you as their own God. Because most of them, everything, they come and tell you what is going on, because they think your solution, you are the last hope they have.
That's true.
So let's start preaching repentance. Because most people that you're telling that witches and wizards are worrying them, is only because they don't have nothing in hand that is a source that God will bless them with. As we all do know, we read the Bible. Even when God sent Moses to Pharaoh's house, now Exodus chapter 4 verse 2, when God asked Moses, what do you have? Because God want to do a miracle through Moses. But Moses said, I have, a lot of people call it the staff, some people call it rod, you can call it a walking stick, whatever you want to call it. But Moses had something in his hand. And that's through there that God was able to do that miracle. So you cannot, every day you go out, you do 6 to 6, which is good, I love it. You go to church every day, I love it. That's good, that's what we're supposed to do, worship God. But in all honesty, what do you have in your hand? What can you do? You have to be able to do something. Make sure you have repented from your sins. Repent from every known sin you committed. And then ask God to bless you through what you do. In Nigeria, even if you sell only pure water, God is going to feed you from there. God is going to bless you from there. Whatever you do, do it good, with your trick. Don't sell Gary and use the backup. Then you ain't getting blessed. So God is going to bless you with every sincerity, whatever you're doing. And you put your time and energy, effort, call it something. Do it with pride. Do it with all honesty. You're going to get blessed. But when you're doing it, is it not only this I'm doing? Yes, do it right. Because if it's somebody else's job, you will get there. If it's 8 o'clock, you'll be there at 8 o'clock. And close by 5 o'clock. If it's your own thing, don't go there by 10 o'clock and get off by 3 o'clock, because there's no market. Stay there, do what you know how to do it, but try to do as the Bible said. So if you are still doing it, going to church saying I receive, is good. But if you're cheating and lying, trying to take somebody else's husband, or trying to cause confusion in somebody else's home in any way through gossip or whatever, you are not going anywhere. Pastors, it's time. Preachers, it's time. We tell the members the truth. We are not going to continue going after everybody's first fruit, after sowing seed. If God did something good for you, come and do this. After those that are alive, come and sow seed. Let's start telling them the truth. Let's help them to get up in the first place. You might be their divine helpers. Instead of you to help them get up, you are still busy trying to take the little one they have. Look around your congregation. They don't have car even to come to work. They don't even have a bike to get there. But you have a Lamborghini. God bless you. What job do you do? Look at them. These are the people you are trying to take every little bit of thing they have in order that they have to sow seed to you. Who are you sowing your own seed to? That's the question that you have to ask. I know some pastors are doing great. Mm-hmm. Some of them are building schools, free schools, build a factory, employ people, help people pay their hospital bill, help people start a business, send people to universities. All those pastors, I say kudos. So we have to be selfless a little bit. Instead of members helping you to build a university, even their own children cannot afford to go there. Let's think and know where we are siphoning, exploiting people instead of showing them the right way and how to serve God, my friend.
Thank you so much, my friend, because actually that's something that you said that I love so much. You said they should preach repentance.
Yes.
Repentance, repentance, repentance. Africa, Africa, my beloved people, I love my people so much. Every day in the church, they tell you the witch did this, the witch did this, the witch did this. And once again, I think I remember there was an episode that I said, if we can take our time to look in the Bible and then also look in the dictionary and find out what is the definition of a witch. Once again, I said our people, because many of us are not educated, the ones that know the meaning, they lie to them. A witch is someone that is wicked. Wicked. So when you look at it, there's a lot of wickedness in our nation, which our people know. They rob each other. They hate each other. Even brothers and sisters, they're like, all right, my brother is working. He's not giving me money. You hate them. Oh, my uncle has a land. I have to take that land. I hate him. So Africa, they're always quarreling it from family to communities, from communities to state. Even in politics, everywhere, they're quarreling. So the pastors and the preachers, the priests, everybody, Africa is in your hand because you have the platform to transform Africa. You know that Africans, they love to follow people. Hmm. And you, as a preacher, people are following you. The congregation, they love you. You're pastor of this. You have multiple congregation. So that means the congregation that you have is a platform to transform Africa. Because even the politicians that we're saying are not doing well in Africa, many of them belong to all these congregations. So you have an opportunity. You have the ability and the capability to transform Africa with your mouth by what you tell them.
That's right.
So when you're there, if you start preaching, just like my friend said about repentance, you tell them adultery is not good. You tell them embezzling money is not good. You tell them taking a land that does not belong to you is not good. You tell them you have to walk to earn money, not steal. You don't have to kidnap. Once you start preaching those things, I'm telling you, you in particular, preachers, will transform Africa even better than people that are coming to develop. Because Africa, we were destroyed from our brain. People would tell you, you don't look good because you're black. You don't do this because you're this. You don't do this. So as long as it was the mouth, word of mouth that destroyed people, it will also be the word of mouth that will transform people.
That's right.
So if you start from your pulpit and tell the people the truth, let them repent. Let them, even when you say repent, it's not even, people will be like, oh, I didn't sin. Change your ways, your wicked ways.
Mm-hmm.
Change it. Once you change your wicked ways, because once your mouth, let me just use a small example. A lot of Africans that have relatives overseas, what they do, they go to bed every day and they're like, my sister is supposed to send me money. My brother is supposed to send me money. My uncle is London. He's not sending money. This one. So he will be thinking, or she will be thinking over and over about that uncle or aunt that live abroad. But what they can do, the same, like I said, if they change their wicked ways and stop thinking of what somebody else is supposed to do for you. And when they're laying in bed, they're like, all right, you know, I'm able to, I can sew clothes, I can make shoes, I can do this, and bring their thinking to themselves. It will transform them, and it will help them to think of something to do to be able to benefit themselves. So that's what you do. You don't have to preach prosperity to people that are poor already. And you're telling them, okay, you have to be rich, you have to be rich. What are you going to do to be rich? You have to do something to be rich. One, stop your wicked ways, and then your mind will be transformed, and then you'll be able to think of solution to your problem. So that's what we're saying. The ball is in your court. Africa, I'm telling you, can be transformed by you from the pulpit. Instead of waiting for people to come to Africa and come and develop Africa and come and do this and come and do this. You know the truth. Tell the people the truth. Our people, they're good people. We all grew up there. Our people, they are hardworking. They're full of wisdom, though many of them are not educated. Because once again, wisdom comes from above. And because our people are very spiritual, they're always in the church praying. That's why they have more wisdom than a lot of people know. And that's why they do well in so many, even little things that they have, they do well because they have wisdom, and wisdom is from God. Mm-hmm. So all you need to do is to tell them the truth, and that wisdom will be transformed into technology and into things that can help to develop Africa. The ball is in your court. Stop lying to the congregation. Go ahead, my friend.
My friend, you have said it all. I love what you said. But what I want to add to all the things you said is for the pastors to let them know, preach to them, tell them, because they will believe you more than they believe any other person out there, because you're the pastor. Let them know that everybody have a talent, because what Mr. A is doing and is working for Mr. A might not be what you're supposed to do. That they have to find out what they are created for, what their own assignment is. And as you're preaching prosperity, you need to let them, because like I said earlier about repentance, our Father is the only prayer our Lord Jesus Christ taught us. Say, forgive us our sins as we forgive those that sin against us. So no matter what you're preaching, no matter what you're doing, even if they sleep in the church, if they're still carrying unforgiveness, acrimony for people that offended them 10 years ago, while they were growing up, what the neighbor did yesterday, what the other person did, the person that killed their father or great-grandfather, and they are still dragging that to church, and every day we are trying to say back to sender, kill them, burn them, scatter them, because we are so angry at the past. They are not looking forward. We have to, do a reverse so that they can look forward. That's the only way they can know what is going on. So let them forgive people that, in one way or the other,
have wronged them,
that have done something bad to them, or that have said something they didn't like, and they're holding that anger. They're holding unforgiveness. Let them forgive. So that's what I want to add. Another thing is that, like my friend said, you have the pulpit. People trust you. That's why there is a lot of churches going on, because the young ones are looking at you. If you can tell me that my uncle is killing me, and then I give you 100,000, now they want to go open their own church because they don't want to serve under you again. Because to them, they have already learned the tricks. And I know some fake pastors among the good pastors, they'll be preaching, close your eyes, the angel of God is coming down to give you, to give everybody 500,000. People are there, leave their bags open. But I say, what betide people that they're using to go put money in those people's bag? That means you're helping them to lie. Please do not promulgate that. That's a lie from the pits of hell. And people are running, not only not to worship God, they are coming so that you can tell them when the next angel will come down to put feeding money in their pocket. This you could do on weekend, like I said. If you don't have food or you don't have a job, come on Saturday, everybody will carry a bag of food. Or you do it unannounced. At the end of the service, take that money, buy food, give everybody a bag that come that day. So that they will know that at least if I go, I will have food to eat that day. So you're helping them openly, instead of telling them that angel come down in the church and be putting money in people's pocketbook, and you're not putting it for everybody, it's the few of them that we get it. So let's preach the truth. Let's maintain that honesty, and let's work for God, not for our own pockets. My dear.
Thank you so much. I think we're done. We're done. We're going to round up. And I'm going to round it up a little bit with this. Don't make God a liar by your preaching. Because what you're doing is that when you deceive people and what you say doesn't come true, they still live in poverty, irrespective of the fact that you keep on telling them, you know, you will get rich, you will get rich, you will get rich. Then it sounds like God is a liar. God is not a liar. Rather, if you keep on doing that, God will make you the preacher a liar. And please, what we said, be merciful to our people. Our people have suffered a lot in the hands of exploitation of others. And now you are an indigene of Africa, and you are exploiting our people in different ways. Please stop. And we're using this opportunity to call criminals that are in the church to step out. A lot of you were criminals. Many of you were released in prison, even in the Western world. Just be honest. They release you in the Western world, and then you run back to Africa, and then you opened up a church. And knowing there that the government is not rigid, and they might not find out what you have done. So if you're a criminal that is hiding in the church, it's not too late. Like my friend said about repentance, you repent and allow the good preachers to preach so that you won't tarnish the image of the good preachers. My dear friend.
My dear.
We are done.
Yes.
You said a word is enough
for the wise.
So once again, thank you so much for listening to us at our Sweet Home Africa, where we bring out some of the challenges that we're facing in Africa and then offer simple advice that we believe will help our people and the government. And don't forget to subscribe.
Subscribe.
Yes.
And this is a weekly show, though. So if it comes out once a week, as you subscribe, you will just be notified as soon as the new episode come out.
Thank you. All right. Your subscription also is an encouragement for us to continue, because the more subscribers that we have, the more we'll keep on doing the show. So please help us to continue this program. Because even if it is one person that can take this advice, it will help to transform Africa. So watch us next week.
At our Sweet Home Africa. And don't forget to comment.